Thank you all for coming today. Are we on? Can you hear us? Wonderful. I think you should be on. If you just want to say, you're on. Testing. Wonderful.
Yes, hello.
Well, I'll start things off by saying I am always in awe of your brilliance on stage and screen, so thank you for being here today.
Well, that's a great pleasure.
The subject matter of this film has always fascinated me. I, like millions of others, followed this story for weeks. So to see this film made so beautifully by the cast and Bennett Miller is amazing. How did this film come about for you, Vanessa?
Well, the film has so overtaken my mind. As I was telling you just now, I've managed to see it twice full. Standing by for a Q&A last week, I sneaked in at the back and managed to see about a fourth of the last fourth of the film again, and I'm longing to see it a third full time. And it's so overtaken my mind, I really find it quite hard to remember where it all began, because I am still so staggered, absolutely astounded by the level of filmmaking, all subsumed within that extraordinary Bennett Miller's vision, but with such particularities from the different departments, cinematography and sound and music, and of course the actors. I'm astonished. Anyway, I mean, I met him and read the script, and I thought the script looked very, very interesting. But it was more, I suppose, the way Bennett Miller talked to me about it that really struck me. Extraordinary.
He is a brilliant director. We have a lot of directors, writers, and actors in the audience today. Mm-hmm. What was it like working with him on this project with Bennett?
Well, as you can see, I was in for a couple of days here and there into Pittsburgh. I absolutely relied on whatever he told me to try and understand that and try and be a kind of transmitter for what he wanted from me as the element that he was looking for to come into this story. And he explained in a very, very good way. I didn't lose my anxiety to try and think, have I got it? Have I got it? I think I've got what you're trying to tell me. But it was very unstressful. At the same time, I was nervous because I could feel I was part of something extremely unusual. And I'm not talking at this second about the story or the truth of the story that made this story. I'm talking about the way I felt, and I know the other actors felt, certainly the crew. There was a, it wasn't kind of Ingmar Bergman time, in that I gather his crews were always miserable, but would always work with him. In fact, when I met Ingmar Bergman's crew, because they shot us years ago in Sydney Lumet's The Seagull, they were amazed because we were all laughing all the time. They said, how can you laugh? And this is a tragedy, isn't it? But we laughed because, and sometimes that's the way a film director works. But the few days that I was on set and actually in a scene, which is in the film, with John du Pont playing his mother. It was a wonderfully concentrated set, and offset too. Does that answer you?
Yes. Is that the trophy scene? That's the scene when
yes.
you're sitting
yes.
with John and you're negotiating.
What are you thinking of doing with the trains? Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
What was it like working on that scene that day? Was there a lot of pre-rehearsal? I know that some directors like a lot of rehearsal, and some actors do and some don't. Was it very organic with you and Bennett and Steve? How did you all work on that scene with rehearsal?
Quite briefly, really. Steve, of course, had come, I don't know, day before, 2 days before, said hello. And I said hello. But that was before makeup, or after makeup, I don't remember which. And I think we both felt, I certainly felt, that it was appropriate to come into the scene, not talking about it, but just listening to whatever Bennett would say he wanted. And of course, Steve was already totally immersed in his character. I mean, he'd been filming for some weeks. And I was a little frightened because I knew it was a very important scene. And I hoped I could transmit it right. I wasn't nervous or afraid that Bennett wouldn't manage to explain to me. I was a bit frightened that I wouldn't manage to understand him. So that's what it was like.
Yeah. And then there's the other scene when your nurse wheels you into the gym, which I love that scene because there's no dialogue. It's just like, I mean, John has some dialogue when he sees you come in, but it's just the look on your face, and it's what's not said in that scene that is so emotional when you watch it.
Well, I think that's true of the approach of the film as a whole, isn't it? It's not telling people what to think, which I love in filmmaking. And very few directors have that approach as a natural gift or a natural skill, whatever we like to call it. But that's his conception, you know?
Yeah.
And somehow I think actors and actresses will agree with me anyway. If you know the director and everybody else knows, you're like a fish swimming with them, and you just come in quietly and swim with everybody. And that's the way you get to do the scene. You don't plan your own little thing, you know? Sometimes one has to plan something because it's being left to the actor or actress to invent whatever they think appropriate. And that can be very nice too. But I love it best when a director is somehow, by some kind of, I don't know what to call it, some kind of an authority that doesn't have to be exerted.
Yeah. And working with this remarkable cast, I mean, I've never seen Channing Tatum like this or Mark Ruffalo. I mean, just beautiful performances.
They're beautiful actors, yes.
Yeah. Steve, I mean, we all know Steve Carell from comedies. What a wonderful, wonderful dramatic actor. What was it like working with all of them? I know you've been touring around doing Q&As with, you know,
your boys. Yes, it's been lovely listening to them. Yeah.
What was it like working with them?
Well, I only really worked with Steve.
Yeah.
Channing and I had a little moment, which we filmed originally. But as I say, it was very unusual and very wonderful. And having now seen the film from the outside, I think Steve and Channing and Mark are just extraordinary. I mean, extraordinary actors. All the more extraordinary. In fact, so extraordinary that it's only, you know, it's of such a high level, and it belongs within the atmosphere and within the editing and the whole vision of the different departments coming together in the coherence of Bennett Miller, you know? So, I mean, I have to want to very much, I mean, just salute Steve, especially because that's a very special character to play. But not because one is better than the other. They're all three just thing,
yeah.
Perfect. And I think all the acting, all the casting, including the maid who comes to the door to open. Fantastic.
Yeah.
That look on her face. I mean, it's almost like a documentary moment.
Yeah.
Caught, the door opens, and the maid didn't know a film camera, didn't know a man was going to be turning up at the door. Just that moment of, and I wouldn't like to put a label on it, and that's, again, the remarkable thing about this film is that because the director didn't want to put labels on anything or anybody or any moment, he wanted to draw people in and to be thinking and listening and working out this and that for themselves, which I think is wonderful. Yeah.
It was brilliant. Everybody who worked on this film, like you said, behind the scenes, everybody was on the same page with the tone that Bennett set.
Yeah.
Yeah, incredible with that. Yeah, sure.
I'm taking the cap home with me.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you so much.
Jean du Pont, did you do a lot of research on her? Do you like to do research when you're playing people like this, or is it something that you and Bennett sort of helped create together to channel her?
No, Bennett created her.
Yeah.
And she herself, as Bennett.
Yeah.
Drew from his knowledge. No, it wasn't something that I would have known how to research, actually. And I guess because from when I first met Bennett, I knew that this was one of the times, because I normally do a lot of research.
Yeah.
Normally a lot have done. But as I just repeat myself in a stupid way, but from the moment I first talked with Bennett, I knew he's my research.
Yeah.
I follow this.
You know, I've had a lot of actors sitting in your chair, and a question that's come up here a lot from actors is, when do you know you're ready to shoot a scene? Is it something that you and the director discuss, or, you know, when you work on a film or something, when you say, I think I'm ready to do this, or do you just know?
Well, it doesn't really work like that.
Okay. We're getting a master class.
You get told to be ready. And I like it. That's how it should be.
Because Jenna Rowland said the same thing. Should her husband always said, I hired you, we rehearsed, we're shooting now.
Well, of course.
Yeah.
Yes.
You know,
yes.
This is a career conversation, so I'd like to mention a few of your memorable performances on stage and screen, if you let me.
All right. Thank you.
You won the Oscar for Julia. Julia fans here. Brilliant performance working opposite your friend Jane Fonda. What was it like working with Jane and Fred Zimmerman?
Well, Fred is a maestro, as you know.
Yeah.
So everything he said or asked for, and he was pretty clear. That was, you know, a wonder to be in one of his films, because I'd seen every film that sometimes catching up, not seeing it at the time it was made, but I'd seen and literally seen The Search when it first came out in England. It came out in, at that time, it got a much bigger general release than a film on that subject made by, as he was then, not so humongously celebrated and respected, younger man. And from that moment on of seeing The Search, I tried to see everything that he'd ever filmed. So I regarded him as a great film master, always did, and when we worked together, I felt the same. And I'll never forget the night before Jane and I were going to do the cafe scene. He said to both of us, individually, not to get together and work it out, but he said to us both individually, and we both knew he'd talk to both of us, said, cut as many of your lines as you think you can. I thought, this is brilliant. Because the lines were all great. I mean, it wasn't, you know, one would be so lucky to always get lines of that quality. It was written by a terrific guy, whose name I'm ashamed I can't remember. Tell me, remind me.
Somebody Google for me, please, who's got their phones on.
Yes.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. So it was a terrific script, yeah, and a terrifically written scene. But Fred saying to me and to Jane to cut my own lines, I cut myself, and I came up with quite a few because I just thought, this is the most wonderful, extraordinary request. And Jane, I know, felt the same. So the result was our scene was like half the size in script terms as originally. And I thought, this is really exceptional. So that's what it was like working with Fred. Of course, I got to know him even more after and for a long time, right the way through till he died. Just had the most enormous, passionate admiration. And Jane and I were both immersed in our characters, and I'll love her forever. Simple as that.
Yeah. I just rewatched Camelot. What am I? I love this film.
I do too.
You playing Guinevere opposite Richard Harris as Arthur and Franco Nero as Lancelot and doing a musical. What was it like for you?
Oh, it was lovely.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yes, I loved all the recording, all the singing classes. I loved the conductor and the guy who was the arranger and working with us on the songs. And then I loved best of all was that I think it was me and Richard went to Josh Logan and said, Josh, why can't we just sing direct on stage and you've got a playback. You can play it back for us and we'll sing to it, but it'll be more alive, it'll be better singing than just doing what up till then had been normal, which is you pre-record and you lip sync. And up till that film, that was pretty well standard. And Josh saying, yes, that would be good, we'll do it. Really, not only I think historically, that was what I regard as a breakthrough, but it was certainly a breakthrough for Camelot.
Yeah. You had a wonderful singing teacher. Was it Yanni Strasser? Who gave you some really great advice, which you've used. Was it drop the leashes or something that you've used his technique throughout your career? Would you mention that?
Yeah, I'd like to. Is this on?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so Yanni Strasser, my father paid me to have classes. Thank you, sorry. Yanni Strasser, my father paid for me to have classes with him. I used to go twice a week to his flat in St. John's Wood with Irena, his wife. They were refugees from the Nazi Hungary. And at the time that I started classes with him. He was coach at Glyndebourne, where he remained coach for a considerable number of years. And he rang me through every time all sorts of exciting exercises. Some of them always the same and some of them new. And I was very excited because I loved singing and I thought he was wonderful to work with. And then one day as I was singing away, feeling pretty good, he said, "Now stop controlling your sound." So of course I listened with great respect as soon as he said that, but I did say, "What exactly do you mean?" And so he explained to me as following. He said, "What you can do inside you, your vocal cords, your breathing, your spirit, which is more important than anything, the thinking and feeling that's coming behind is the motor force for these notes and these songs. These are tools, but let's call them poodles. And your poodles are very well trained, but you're keeping them on a tight leash all the time. You're controlling what they've got to do, where they've got to go. And they're good at that. But if you just let them go and trust them to do what they can do, it would be so much better." And that was some, thank you for raising that, because that was a very, very important lesson. And it remains to me a very important lesson. I now, for quite a while, taken it to myself. You know, in all sorts of areas of life, especially acting and singing, because that's what he was talking about specifically, but try and make sure that the circumstances, you just trust more, let go more, and have faith that for better, for worse, and it'll always be better for some reason or another, yeah, for better, for worse, things will come out much better than if they're all controlled. And I happen to believe that that's kind of a lesson for anyone who thinks democracy is a good thing.
Yeah. The Devils, you got to work with the late, great Ken Russell, who I got to meet like 6 months before he passed away. And I'm a huge fan of Ken Russell, so it was great to sort of meet him. What was it like working with Ken Russell on that movie and getting to know him?
Well, it was turbulent in a great way. He would sometimes lose it, as they say, and shout at the crew in a way that I didn't think was appropriate. But he was a genius, an absolute genius. And you know, if you know someone is a genius because you've seen their work they've done and you're sensing from what they've chosen to do, as he'd chosen in The Devils to work with Derek Jarman and to make not go off to a medieval town in France as a location, but to build white walls for all the scenes and modern furniture and things like that with the, what are they, early 17th, late 16th century costumes. I thought, well, straight off, he and Derek Jarman you've got something really special there. So I admired him immensely. And immensely. And then he worked with my daughter, Natasha. They did a film together. And I'm still struggling to find a copy of it. Gothic, I think it was called.
I'll keep my eye out for that.
Would you?
Oh,
thank
yeah.
You.
I've got a friend who does a lot of that stuff, who can find something for you. You've done a lot of incredible work on the small screen also. Something that comes to mind is Second Serve, when you starred as transgender tennis star Renee Richards. I remember watching this. Yes.
Thank you. Thank you.
Where you played both roles. You played him as Dr. Richard Radley, and then the woman he became, Renee Richards. What was that whole undertaking and the transformations like for you and working on that film?
Well, it was wonderful. It was an eye-opener because I didn't know anything about transgender or tranny, as they say now. I didn't know anything. I didn't meet Renee before we filmed, not from any conscious decision on anybody's part. It just wasn't possible, but I think it was a good thing. I did meet her afterwards, and that was a good thing. But throughout the filming and prior to the filming, I was meeting a lot of girls and women who were telling me their story of what had happened and the terrible difficulties, I mean, awful difficulties that they'd been faced with, both in terms of legal, civic, federal, whatever, legislation and rules, but also because friends who'd been friends or family, some members of the family, sometimes all not, absolutely not understanding, thinking they were mad, so on, which comes across, I think, in the film. So I learned a lot. And of course, I was given by some of the women I met some articles to read, which threw light on the scientific, good, real scientific articles. And that made me realize that, as a matter of fact, it was, I think it may have been the first time I realized the infinite variety of human beings, core through in everything, infinite variety. I'm just trying to remember, I may not manage to, Richard. I think it's in Hamlet. Well, I'll keep you waiting forever if I, sorry.
We don't mind.
All right.
Was it interesting playing the male part? Was that more challenging or what was that?
Oh, no.
Yeah.
No, it wasn't more challenging. I mean, I've got things going for me, obviously. I'm extremely tall.
Yeah.
I'm used to be strong. Did a lot of sport, did a lot of dancing for years. So I could carry, I could lift. So that came in handy for babies anyway. And I think, you know, I've probably got all sorts of sides in me. Physical, sexual, cerebral, I don't know. I mean, at the time I wasn't thinking about it, it may seem odd, because my father was bisexual. He and I never talked about bisexual. I never thought it was anything unusual at all, because I had that attitude. That was the attitude of my family and the people my family were close to, their friends. I mean, you know, my father had lovers, my mother had lovers, and they adored each other. It seemed to me that's how it should be.
Yes. Well, I'd like to talk a little bit about some of your theater work here in New York, because the journey that actors and audiences go on together is something pretty special. And I want to go back to the Tennessee Williams play, Orpheus Descending. Your brilliant portrayal of Lady Torrance. What did that role, that company of actors, including Kevin Anderson, and working with Peter Hall mean to you with working on that?
Oh my God, that's humongous.
Yeah, big question.
Well, first of all, of course, there's the issue of Tennessee, and the original play that became Orpheus Descending, and in which he'd had a disaster and been booed out of Boston pretty well. And the director had told him, Tennessee, you must stop wearing your heart on your sleeve, which he never managed to do that. Anyway, he'd gone much further into the Sicilian context and background of Lady's family. Lady. And because I've been for years with Franco Nero, and Franco's always got friends everywhere. So he's got Sicilian friends and friends from every quarter of Italy. And I had a chance to speak to some of his Sicilian friends, some of whom were knowledgeable just out of sheer love, not out of profession. In fact, they were cooks. But they knew and loved music. And they'd explain what different kinds of music meant, instruments, but as well the songs. And the songs from Sicily, as I realized, the songs from Sicily came from the mines, just as so many of American, great American ballads come from the mines in Virginia, Harlan County, etc. And of course, there was a crossover because of the immigrant migration. Everybody desperate from Sicily to find a new life. That didn't mean sending children down into the copper mines and not seeing them for a year. And of course, clearly, though I don't know all the facts about it and have forgotten the ones I did, but clearly there was a need for cheap labor in the mines in Virginia and up and down the Appalachians and so on. So there was a big cross current culturally, spiritually, and getting to know a little bit more deeply about that helped me enormously understand about playing Lady Torrance. I was slow for a while because I couldn't make up my mind, and Peter went along with, he didn't suggest anything different, to play with an American accent, because since she's been five, she's grown up in America, southern state of America, unspecified. But then one day, I began to detect certain rhythms in Tennessee's English text written in English, in which he hadn't, like Eugene O'Neill would try and approximate to a foreign accent, wouldn't he, especially Swedish. But Tennessee never tried to do that. But I began to detect there were kind of sonar waves, am I right? I don't know, of something that wasn't American, except insofar as it the person lived and worked in America, which has its importance. And so one weekend, I was talking with Tony Richardson, who'd produced a wonderful Italian actress in, what's it called, The Fugitive Kind, I think the film, an early version was called, anyway. And he directed Isa Miranda, and she was Italian, and so on and so forth. And of course, everybody, including myself, knows that Anna Magnani. So one weekend, I thought, I've got to play this with an Italian accent. And so how was it like working with Peter Hall? It was simply great, because I came down to Cardiff, and we did a word run, which I always like to do for real, not speed. And the cast were looking at me, what's Vanessa doing? And I said, well, I'm feeling that I ought to be playing this with an Italian accent. And Peter Hall said, yes, I think you should, because something different is coming out of you.
Wow.
So, But I did love that play.
Yes.
And we had some extraordinary cast and Wonderful.
Yep. And then you won the Tony Award for the role of Mary Tyrone in Eugene O'Neill's Long Day's Journey and Tonight.
Yeah.
Now, when I saw that, I was sitting in the first row to the left by that big chair that you sat in, and I remember vividly the burning intensity of your performance and watching your fingers, your gnarled hands. I was riveted by that performance. What was it like tackling her and doing that?
Oh, it was grim.
Oh, I can imagine.
It was very grim. But we actors trusted each other, and we each carried our huge burden, each one of us, the two sons, the wife, and Tyrone, her husband, the father. I mean, it was literally going, just before going on, Phil Seymour Hoffman and I would be going, literally, both of us, independently. We weren't doing it for fun. We weren't doing it. We were just doing it out of sheer necessity. A big breath out, a groan. Terrifying. Absolutely terrifying. But sometimes you come to discoveries through terror.
Was it one of the hardest roles you've ever taken on?
Definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All of you. I mean, just you.
Oh. All of us. For yeah. All of us. Yeah.
We're in this together.
Yeah.
Just brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. You mesmerized audiences in the Year of Magical Thinking. Joan Didion's play about grief, directed by David Heyer. I read that you said that the preparation for your appearance in this play was the most demanding of your career. Is that true?
Well, yes, because I'd never done a play in which there was one character.
Yeah.
And nobody else to talk to, except the audience. So that's difficult to learn. And part of David's wonderful input during rehearsals was to explain to me and teach me and practice that every day of speaking specifically to various people in the audience, who of course I wouldn't know beforehand. He had rows of chairs, nobody sitting in them mostly, and round oval faces, but just round ovals on each chair. And he'd say, I want you to choose a specific person there and there and there and there. And it was a very necessary kind of five-finger exercise, because you absolutely have to, if the play is one person speaking to the audience and has to share with them, and a person whose reticence is not revealed, is only revealed through writing, not through acting, through the words she speaks, the thoughts she expresses. Although she does speak a lot, 1.5 hours is quite a lot. And I was very nerve-wracked. Jolie, my daughter's playing Emily Dickinson right now.
Brilliant, in the Belle of Amherst.
Yeah. Well, she's alone on the, also about 1.5 hours. And she several times said to me, were you this nervous? I said, yes. I sometimes literally... It was almost as if I had to be pushed on by our wonderful stage manager and magical thinking. I'd grip her hand, I'd grip the crew man who stood at her side for the everything to get going. And because, well, you're bearing the character, not oneself. But without oneself's involvement in the character and in the audience, it remains a sterile exercise. Last night I read chapters I'd chosen in the Cathedral of St. John the Divine, together with Jimmy Owens, who's a great jazz master on the trumpet and the flugelhorn, and we read and Jimmy played. I mean, Jimmy and I must have had 2 afternoons to rehearse together, plus one in the cathedral yesterday, yeah, with everything. But in this case, we were doing it for Joan, and we were doing it for Quintana, her daughter, and her husband, John Gregory Dunn, the writer. And they'd been good friends of my first husband, Tony, and my daughter.
Yes.
So, but her family, Joan's family, are all buried in St. Ansgar's Chapel, up on to the right of the high altar. So it's kind of a special. You can't have ego in a cathedral. You can't have ego. And that's always good to be reminded of. Out ego, out ego, out, out, out.
Beautiful. We have a lot of actors in the house today, so were you ever frightened of going up on dialogue in that evening on stage at the Booth Theater? And what
certainly
did
was.
David give to you of how to handle that? Because he had done a one-man show.
He was direct and wonderful. Yeah. Because he had done Via Dolorosa himself, solo on stage, 1 year or 2 years before. And he said to me at one point, well, listen, I guess it was as we were in tech or coming up to our first previews. Anyway, certainly. And he said, look, there will come times when you get a total blank. He said, I did. David said he would sweat, pour down, because he couldn't think. And it was him, his words, and he couldn't think. That's that extra thing that happens in theater. And he said, but don't worry, just stay there, wait, and it'll come to you. Now, we did have, because I'd said, please, it would be a big help if we had the assistance of a wonderful, actually, she's a wonderful young actress, too, JoJo Carlin. And she was working with us, and so JoJo would be ready to prompt. But I think David had probably told her, don't ever prompt. And luckily, she never did. Luckily, because he wanted me to go with that fear of what happens when you don't know what you're going to say. And I found that automatically, I'd hide my face. I'd hide my face. It was automatic. I didn't plan it. I just did it each time, and it happened a few times. But I just held in there, and sure enough, either the right words came back, or we jumped about 4 pages. And later that evening when I came off, the stage manager would tell me, well, it was very good, Vanessa, but you do realize that you cut from page 30 to page 35.
It was a shorter evening at the theater that night.
Strangely enough, I think, you know, for that evening, it probably didn't matter, because what's important is to be in the moment. And that's what David was trying to get through to me. You know, just stay in there. Stay in that moment. Yes, you could carry on quicker if someone gives you a cue, but it's better. Then you come out of the moment. It's great to know someone is there. It's great to know that I could do what my father said to me, a wonderful, great actress at the time, when he played Orlando to her Rosalind in As You Like It. And she was about 52 and he was about 29. And he fell madly in love with her, and she with him too. But that's beside the point. And at some point in one of their scenes, she forgot. She went up, as they say. She didn't know what she was going to say. He probably was so in awe of her that he didn't know what to prompt her with. Some actors are wonderful, and they'll help you, remind you what you're supposed to say. And she would literally suddenly leave him and dance into the wings and get her cue and dance back on and carry on the scene. That's how some people have managed it.
That's one great way of doing it.
Sort of. I would never dare, but the final analysis is you can always go into the wings, get your prompt and come back on.
Come back on again.
But then, if you then faint through shame at having let down everybody, so.
Taking on Miss Daisy, playing opposite James Earl Jones in Driving Miss Daisy. Because you did it here and then over in?
In England.
In England.
Yes.
What was that whole experience like working with James?
Well, we did magical thinking.
Yeah.
We did magical thinking as well. With working with Jim is great.
Yeah.
Absolutely great.
Yeah.
He's got a huge philosophical field within him. He's a wonderful person to listen to. Absolutely wonderful. I say that because a couple of times we were interviewed together about working together. But my God, he's in the kind of man he is, you know, pours out of him and permeates not just the stage but the whole building. He's great.
Yeah.
I long to work with him again.
Yeah. And then recently you worked with Jesse Eisenberg, who I adore as a writer and an actor, in The Revisionist, which had the Cherry Lane.
Yeah, I did. And I loved Jesse. I loved his play. I loved the Cherry Lane. It's just about my most favorite theater in the world, actually.
Because it's so intimate, right? And it fit that place so well because of the apartment that
you
lived in, your character, right?
Well, there is a real place for intimate theater. And I often wish Shakespeare could be played more intimately rather than in the huge places where directors get excited by huge things happening, you know? And I don't want to put down their imaginations because there is a place for that. But my ideal, personal ideal, is to play Macbeth in a room that's about a quarter this size because it's very psychological. And the prose and the poetry, oh, God, the intensity. And it shouldn't have to be broadcast, as it were. Actors can do it. Of course they can. We can be mic'd beautifully, of course we can. But something's gone. Something's gone. I saw my brother play Macbeth in a very small, tiny room in Battersea, Battersea Art Centre. It was an astonishing production because, of course, there couldn't be really any set, just the back, thin, small back wall. And on either side was audience, sort of more circle in the square, as it usually is. Audience on three sides. It was the most compelling Macbeth I've ever seen. Sorry, I think I've strayed way off.
No, you didn't. Talking about intimate spaces, it's all about Shakespeare's words. I agree with you fully. It should just be an actor doing what they do, with just in a black box or something, and just telling those great stories and saying those great words. You know what? We have a little time. We'd like to open some questions. If you have any questions for Miss Redgrave, if you'd stand and.
Or Vanessa.
Oh, Vanessa. I'm sorry. I keep.
Thank you.
Thank you. I love this, Vanessa. If you've got questions for Vanessa, come on down. You can line up on either side in front of the microphones. Don't be shy.
Could the mic not go to the mountain? No,
yeah, they have mics. They have mics over there.
Oh, great.
Yeah, so come on down. Say hello.
Because it's a bit of a deal getting up and.
Yeah.
Hello. Anyway, hooray. Steve, hello.
In the 50s, I had the pleasure of seeing your mother and father at Stratford-on-Avon in a series of plays with Peggy Ashcroft.
Yeah.
Now, this story is about every Wednesday they gave little talks like this, and your mother was asked whether she would like her children to go into the theater, and she said, absolutely not. And I'm up here to thank you for not listening to your mother.
Hi, good afternoon. Hi. I don't know if you can hear me. Anyway, thank
no,
you.
No, it's is it up enough? Can it be turned up a bit?
Can they turn that mic up a little bit?
Hello, okay. Hello. Anyway, I'll speak louder.
That sounds better.
Okay. Thank you so much for being here, Miss, I have to say, Miss Redgrave.
Okay.
Thank you so very much. And first of all, I want to say that thank you from the bottom of my heart for all the work you do on behalf of human rights. I have to say that to you.
Thank you.
Now, what I would like to ask you is if you could please talk a bit about a lot of things you've done I've loved, like Isadora, shot by my friend Larry Pizer, and... But my favorite thing you've done, I think, is a TV movie, Remember Playing for Time?
Yes, of course.
Could you please talk about that a little bit, working on Playing for Time?
Well, I think I can only talk about it from this perspective, because jumping into 1993, 13 years at least after we'd filmed Playing for Time, I invited Anita Lasker, who was one of the players in the Auschwitz Orchestra, and another Holocaust survivor, Esther Brunstein, to join and speak in a conference I organized in a theater up in the north of England in Manchester. It was both a conference and a concert. For what was happening, and we did it as a benefit for UNICEF's work in what at that time was being called former Yugoslavia, i.e. throughout all the republics during the war. And two people who'd become friends and become refugees and were living with me with their tiny little 18-month-old daughter, who'd been singing it in Sarajevo the day that snipers had started shooting from the top of the Holiday Inn, singing in an anti-war rally. A lot of others took part. Dan Day-Lewis took part. A lot of others took part. Yeah, some of our best comedians took part. But also, Anita Lasker and Esther Brunstein participated in the conference. And they both said, adamantly and rightly, that nothing could be compared to the planned destruction of the Jews in Eastern Europe, the Holocaust. But they both also said that the ferocity of what was being called ethnic cleansing, mm-hmm. did strike home deeply to both of them, and that they feared that the world was standing by once again, and to do nothing, or a little bit by as far as human beings were concerned, but governments just standing by and seeing civilians and kids. So we had musicians singing. We had 500 young Bosnian refugees. My brother organized a coach to come up from London. So that was 3/4 of the theater was full. We had some rappers from Manchester. They were great. We had a whole cross the board. And unfortunately, this is really a subject to talk about and discuss for an hour and not in passing. But I think we're all playing for time in a different way.
Yes, exactly.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello. I want to thank you very much for coming here and gracing us with your presence. You have been a mentor, a role model to me ever since I became an actor. So I'm thrilled that I even get to ask you a question. And it really is, first of all, I did see when playing for time, and I have to say something. I read in the New York Times, I think it was, that not only did you do this incredible feat, but I heard that Joan was changing the script at times in the beginning, and you had to even, at the last minute, to learn these new phrase or new paragraphs. I mean, is that true, that even as you had this almost insurmountable feat of speaking for an hour and a half, that's not my real question, though, that you had script changes. Was that true?
Sorry. It's not, clearly, but I think you've got a point there.
Oh, I haven't quite got. When you were working on Playing for Time, yeah. Were there changes?
You mean magical thinking.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, the year of magical thinking.
I got so
thinking,
taken with
Joan
your
Didion's.
Story. I meant, in the year of magical thinking. Thank you. Were there script changes as you were actually performing it that you had to learn and adapt to?
No.
It was all set in the beginning?
Oh, yes.
Oh, okay, so that didn't happen.
I think we changed about 2 lines eventually at some point during rehearsal.
Oh, wow, okay.
Yeah.
Here's my real question, because I'm so happy that you're here to share with us. I am curious a little bit. Your work is one quality of it, is many qualities, but one I find it's very visceral.
Did you say polity?
Quality. Of your work.
Quality, sorry.
Of your acting, your work.
Yeah, sorry.
I find your work to be magnificently visceral. There's something very deeply connected to any character that you play. And in fact, which gives credence to why you can play a scene with no words, as we just saw, and it speaks volumes. I'm wondering a little bit about your approach. When you get a script, do you start thinking about the character first? Or I've heard some actresses put the script away so they can just sort of connect. Or is it through research? Or if you could speak a few words about when you are given a role to play, I know it's a big question, but if you could encapsulate a few thoughts of how you approach playing the character.
Yes, I can try to. I'll probably speak for far too long, but I think I've already explained as best as I could about playing Mrs. DuPont, Jean DuPont, or Pont. Yeah.
I sort of mean in but general.
No, I know you wanted, but there's always a particular, I can give you an example of the kind of research that I still do, although the example I'm going to give you goes way, way back to when I was playing Boletta in The Lady from the Sea, not The Lady from the Sea, who I've also played in 4 different productions. But it's an example of how I work on some plays, not in film, but in some plays. In that case, I wanted to know exactly where the little town that's referred to in Ibsen's script, I wanted to know where it was. So I went to all the old bookshops and looking for the old tourist guides, and eventually came across an old tourist guide from Norway in the right time. I didn't buy it, but I wanted to read it. And I found a little description, about 2.5 pages actually, about Molde and where it was on the edge of the fjord and how many ferries coming in and out every day and where the post office was and where the vicar or pastor, being Lutheran, the church, I mean, all those little details. And I was, that's the kind of work I sometimes do, because I can't feel I can get to know why, in this case, a young daughter longs to get out of this place. I had to know, and then I had to find out, okay, what jobs were available in the capital city, for instance, if any girl had the courage to get out and go south. So, to Oslo. So I had to find out about the jobs she might have done, what they would paid at that time. You know, it's going back, it's a real historical study. But I had to know. So I do sometimes do that work. And as a matter of fact, of course, I did a massive amount of research on the film Isadora. But in the case of, let's say, Long Day's Journey Into Night, I had to know about opium. And so I went to, with the help of a very kind doctor, put me in touch with some people at Sloan Kettering, pain management. And they told me about pain management and how it introduced me to patients who were on pain management in that particular department. And so then I was able to obviously ask some questions from the doctors, trying not to take up too much of their time, about pain management back in the old days. Mm-hmm. And so you learn a lot of something you just have to know about. You've just got to know about. So that's really the best I can do, and thank you very much for your question.
That's a beautiful answer. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sir, over here.
Vanessa.
It's Jimmy. Oh, God, hooray. We were together last night in the cathedral for Joan Didion.
Oh, welcome.
Thank you. And I'm faculty member here.
And you teach here. Yes, you teach here.
Vanessa,
Jimmy Owens.
I wanted to say that you left out a very important person that last night was dedicated to, and that's you. Because that's why I did that, because you were going to be involved with it. And it was very special for me working with you. I love you.
We have time for one more right over here, sir.
Thank you, Jimmy.
We have one right over here to the right.
It was just really beautiful to watch. I just have two quick questions. One would be for an upcoming actor, what would a big piece of advice that you would wish to have known at this time of your life be, if you could relay that advice? And second, some of us drama students here in 2 weeks are doing a production of Titus Andronicus, and we wanted to invite you if you would like to come. So hit me up for details if you would like to come see that. I'm inviting you. And, yeah.
Advice?
Yes.
Can it be two bits?
Yeah.
One is work in the voice, run, exercise, gym, anything in your exercises in your own apartments, in a gym, where school, or wherever you can, with others is always better. But if you can't do it with others, do it on your own in your where you sleep or whatever, in a corridor where you're working, studying, performing regularly. So you get the breath developing. Do lots of voice exercises. Find out if you can a really, really good singing teacher, because I was taught that it's singing that best develops the speaking voice, even if you've got no plan to be a singer, and even if you think or people tell you, well, you haven't got much of a voice, it doesn't matter. Sing, because your voice will be, and you've got to get to the point eventually, you're aiming for being that what you are made of in flesh, the tools you have, your lungs, your feet, flexibility, adaptability, are completely responsive to what you're trying to show. And not just show, but show to yourself, show as a human being, I mean, that isn't you, or however close to you. Obviously, Titus Andronicus, none of you will find yourselves very close to the characters in that.
Hopefully not.
Absolutely. It's a terrifying play. I saw it performed in Croatia during the war, actually. It was a terrifying production and very brilliantly done. And I also saw Laurence Olivier play at Stratford-on-Avon. Peter Brook, extraordinarily beautifully directed. But the other piece of advice is just really a kind of hold in there, because, you know, there are so many times when you're young and they continue coming. They're not unique to when you're young, when you feel pretty much in despair, either because nobody seems to want you for a job, you know, or that one, or because you yourself know you don't know how to do what you want to know how to do. So just, it's like Nina says at the end of The Seagull, have faith. And it's very hard. It's the hardest thing in the world. But at least with you, stick in with your friends and just keep working on the voice, reading some wonderful plays, even if you can't perform them. Get together and read them so that you're not atrophying. You're learning new themes, new subjects, new moments of history, new characters, and you're sharing them with each other, even if you haven't got an audience. Or invite a few people along to come and see it. You know, it's hard, but that's what to do. Okay.
Thank you so much.
We unfortunately are out of time. So my final question for you is your passion for acting as strong today as it was when you were starting out?
It's different. I don't know if it's as strong, but it's different. I mean, obviously, I'm at the age when, and it happens to all actresses for sure. I can't speak for the men, but it happens to all actresses. You're just thinking about your grandchildren and wanting to spend more time with your grandchildren. And that if you could retire, you'd probably like to semi-retire anyway, but who can afford to today? I can't. I mean, it's that simple. So, but the passion I had when I was young was a passion that was extremely pure in the specific sense that I didn't know about ill faith, lack of faith. They were not in my world, my experience. I was very idealistic, and My father was a very good father in the one specific. I'm not saying it was the only specific. He encouraged me to read the autobiographies of some of the great old dancers, Kasavina being one, Nijinsky, Nijinska, some of the Russians, and some of the Americans. And it was he who put me in touch with what a new world of wonder American theater was when I was a student, because it was. I mean, Britain, forget it. Forget it. It was New York was, I'll never forget coming to New York. And I'm sorry, I'm rambling on. I came to New York in 1955. It was my second year as a drama student. And the acting, and I went to the actor's studio for some sessions to watch, to observe. So I saw Eli Wallach and Annie Jackson do a piece, which was impeccable. And I saw various other actors who I'm sure were famous actors having their work dissected, or rather analyzed. And the people I saw on stage and the plays, they were new plays. And I saw some wonderful musicals as well. I saw Now View from the Bridge is done so frequently in London. I don't know about here, but I know there was a London production that came here with, I think, Liev Schreiber.
Yes.
Yeah. I would love to have seen him in that.
Brilliant.
Yeah. I bet. Well, there's brilliant acting in London, too. That's a play that I saw in 1955 with the original actors. And I, of course, the passion of the American actors, all going to work, to study, to dance, to sing, to explore. And you're so clear in their work. It was, I came back and got together with another actor in my class, and we just resolved, you know, this, we've got to explain somehow, we've got to get across here in London as drama students. We'll make a magazine, we'll write in the magazine, we're going to search out all the new people, we're going to really try and convey what passion is and dedication to the theater and performing and the performing art. I know this isn't, but I mean, you know, I have to say it as a last word, because I think I've learned as much from working in film about working in the theater as I have vice versa, perhaps even more actually, because I still find it true what Tony Richardson said to me, the first film that I was going to make. And he said, don't start working it all out in your head about, well, before this scene, this has happened, and remember, and the very beginning, and working it all out, it's not going to help you. Yeah. This is not how films are made. You must live in the moment. And you must live in that moment under, with, together, the director's vision. Because even if you, Vanessa, or any actor, actually had a better insight, more this, more that, more the other, etc., it's his film. You've got to make his film. Otherwise, it'll be a disaster. Okay. That's
perfect.
It.
Perfect. Thank you for one of the most beautiful afternoons I have spent, and I have done this for a long time.